Healthy Families. We have a special guest tonight, Riley. She's been part of the Welcome Wellness family for a few years now, and she's seen a lot of changes, and she's very talented. So we're very lucky to have her here tonight. So let me introduce Riley here. To wellness. The other night I asked my 6-year-old daughter, I go, Eliana, why do you get adjusted? She said, well, to make my body healthy. And I thought, that's a right answer. That's a great answer. And you know, I thought about it and I go, well, this is how we start to create healthy communities and society, by teaching our children and leading by example, right? They mimic what you do and they copy it. Tonight, Dr. Phil, unfortunately, Dr. Ummer won't be here. She's ill. She really wanted to be here. Dr. Phil is going to be talking about how to raise a healthy family using the five fundamentals of health. Who knows what those five fundamentals are? Anybody going to help me? I'm going to start. First one is? Yes?
Mind.
Mind, yes. Mindset. Second? You got it there. Okay, yes. We got mind, nerve supply, lean muscle and oxygen, nutrition, and minimizing toxins. So all five fundamentals we know work together for optimal health. And that's what we all strive for. Our mission overall, not just Welcome to Wellness, our mission is to create the healthiest community in Canada, right? Making Durham Region one of the healthiest communities. So, and we do that by helping one person at a time, that leads to one family at a time. Okay. Now I'm going to introduce Dr. Phil. He's been a chiropractor in Durham Region for now, this year is going to be 25 years.
Thank you very much.
Oh, I'm not done. he's been helping thousands of families lead a healthy lifestyle. He's helped newborns to professional athletes. Okay? So now, without further ado, welcome Dr. Phil.
Thanks very much, Mark. Hey, Brian, can I just bring you back for a sec here? I want to brag about that. Okay, so we'll come on this side. So they're telling me, because they're recording Facebook Live, so you did an awesome job. I mean, that's amazing. It gives me, I don't know, when singers are amazing, they give me goosebumps and my hair is on as it was when I heard the first time that you sung. You've got a YouTube video there. So I just want to say that Riley, you know, she's an actor, she's a singer, as you can tell. She does dance, she's into different sports. You know, she's on the honor roll, she's in grade 8 right now, but it wasn't always that way for Riley, right? And so back in grade 1, so back to grade 1 when she couldn't focus in class, by grade 2 you got put on the ADHD meds, you couldn't focus. And then what happened was, a couple years into it, I'm not sure when the symptoms started, but you started to actually feel like digestion, you didn't feel like eating, you didn't really feel yourself, you said to me. So if any of this isn't true, you just pipe up and tell me. But basically what you said is that now, you said, well, I can't digest my food, I don't feel hungry, I just don't feel myself, I couldn't like communicate with others the way I normally would. And some people, you can describe it as a zombie-like, but some people describe it that way. So you were even questioning, was it even working for you? And then fast forward, then you started to come in between grade 5 and grade 6. You started to get adjusted. You know what we found? What did we find in the first visit of your visits here?
I didn't have a curve in my neck, so nothing was getting up my head.
Yeah, so this part of your neck, so it wasn't allowing the brain to do its communication properly down. And as it turns out, it affects neurotransmitters. We'll tell you more about that. So now you notice that there's been an improvement. You were able to get off the medications, which is congratulations for you.
Thank you.
And so what we ask people is, if Einstein and Thomas Edison had have been around today, they would have the same symptoms. What would they have been put on? Probably the same medication. And if they were kept on it, maybe we wouldn't have the light bulb. Maybe we wouldn't have the theory of relativity and all the things that they created. So for you, I think, well, maybe we wouldn't have the superstar right here being her best. And that's really our mission, is to help people become their best, to live life to their fullest, to their God-given potential. And I think that's a fine display of potential right there. Did I miss anything, Mom? Did I miss anything on that? Or anything to add? Riley, I'm going to give you a hug. Thank you so much. That was so awesome. And I would love to have you back as a guest singer again. So hopefully when you make it big, you're gonna have a chiropractor on your tour, right? All right, so that's awesome. So what I want to do is hopefully we'll see how this goes. Yep, fantastic. Okay, so I'm lucky enough to be a co-author of this book, and we're gonna share some secrets with you. We're not gonna keep them secrets tonight. There are so many resources for this. And so Diane, I'm gonna ask you after if you can pull some of those up on the computer, the resources. So our mission is to help you live your highest potential that you can. But in order to do that, we have to educate you about what health and healing really is. And we need to change people's mindsets on how they view and manage their health. That's really because most people are doing certain things, but they're not following our five fundamentals. They don't even know about half of them. And so I'm asking, why is this so important in this day and age? Don't you think that we're getting better as a society with health, and especially in Canada, don't we have one of the best healthcare systems in the world, right? And arguably we do. However, what's happening with the rates of disease for kids? Is autism going up or down? Are more kids being put on ADHD meds and psychotropic drugs? We'll be talking to psychotropic later. Are more kids being put on inhalers like I was on for 9 years? What's happening with antibiotic use? Is it going up or down? When we even know that antibiotics don't help a lot of infections now, and it's going up. And we're going to be giving you life stories today that will change the way you view and manage your health for sure. And so it's alarming right now that from 2000, the stats with autism are showing that they've doubled in about 16, 17 years. And Dr. Sedov has calculated that if it keeps going at the rate it is now currently, that by one out of every two kids by 2025, there's a possibility by 2025 that they'll have an autism spectrum disorder. All right, that's alarming. Whatever that number is, we know it's going the wrong way. And so back 25 years ago when I started practice as a chiropractor, we didn't see kids having plaque in their arteries. And now kids are having plaque in their arteries. Now we're seeing they're having high blood pressure. We're seeing they're getting type 2 diabetes, more common than ever before. We didn't see it in kids. It used to be called adult onset. Now it's called type 2 because kids are getting it. It's staggering. I didn't see 25 years ago, I didn't see kids on their x-rays showing arthritis like in their teenage years. I'm seeing that now. And there's reasons. We're going to discuss why that's occurring. There's reasons why it's happening. And we know we can actually prevent that. So the good news is there's hope. That's the best thing. You know, like Riley's a perfect example about breaking out of her shell, so to speak, becoming her best. And that what happens is that there's two real thoughts to health. There's two philosophies of health, two paradigms of action. So I'm gonna ask you right now, when you enter the healthcare system, right, when do you first go to a doctor, especially children, when do they go? Yeah, they most of the time go when they're already sick. So from our wellness perspective, is that they're already behind the eight ball. I want you to think of a health spending account, like a bank account for your health here. And so by the time you reach symptoms that you can see here on this line, by the time you reach these symptoms, then we think you've already depleted your health account and you're going into an overdraft situation. So what happens when you go to the doctor? And they're going to take your symptoms and they're going to put it into a label and they call it either a condition or a disease. And what do you normally get for that? We get a medication or possibly a surgery or more medications or so on. So we just discussed how that's working for many diseases or conditions. It's not really helping that much. In fact, the rates are getting worse. So what our thought is, instead of fighting the actual disease, we want to build your health up. We know that there are five determinants of your health. That's why we call them the five fundamentals. And our mode is not to fight the disease or the symptom, but to actually build your body up so we can be healthy, so that you can be at your best ability. And so these building blocks, we call the five fundamentals. I want to share an example, like cancer. So I think most people know, do we have cancer cells in us at all times? And so what stops a person from walking to this side and getting on the disease side and having the diagnosis of cancer and having that take over their body? What's the difference between somebody else on this side having cancer cells but not having any troubles with function in their life? what is it in our bodies that takes care of the cancer cells? The immune system. So instead of in medicine, they will attack the cancer, the pathogen, they'll give it chemo, radiation, they'll cut it out. And I'm not saying don't do that. I mean, thank God we have doctors on this side of the line that will help you in a crisis. Okay, we're not saying don't go, we're not saying don't use it. But what we're saying is that will never build your health. It can't build health. In the bank account of health, the savings account doesn't go up when you take a drug. It actually goes down. So it helps you recover from that illness, but it never actually, you know, adds to your bank account or your health account. And so in our model, we are actually going to find what is stopping your immune cells from fighting that cancer. What's stopping it? What are the five things we test and measure? So when you come to our office, we'll actually test you and measure as to what that is. And so that's the difference between building health. We don't fight cancer. We don't treat cancer. We don't treat back pain. We don't treat asthma. We don't treat anything. We build your body up so it can do the job to be healthy. That's the difference. That's the wellness philosophy. So these five fundamentals are vital to you becoming your health. And I think that if I ask people, if we put almost anybody on an exercise, if anybody went on an exercising and nutrition program, would their health improve? What do you think? Do you think so? Yeah, it's going to go up. So what do you think anybody, if I put them on a nutrition plan and an exercise plan and it was better than what they had before, would anybody go the other way and go towards disease, do you think? You think that's possible? Well, in the lifestyle medicine guidelines, of which I've taken my certification through Harvard Medical School, so that what we know is that exercise is the number one thing that's been shown to help every disease. There isn't one disease that you can name that exercise doesn't help, and the research is staggering for that. Nutrition is similar. And so what we know is that the mindset is important as well as exercise and nutrition. And so I want to talk about the mindset here, because many of the kids come in and they think that they have a condition. Like myself, I thought I had asthma and that I had a condition, and that just some days when my asthma was bad, I just wasn't going to be able to run as fast as the other kids, right? So people with ADHD might be saying, I just can't focus, I've got this condition, well, it's just my condition. And they think that they have no hope to get better. And I want to tell you that's furthest from the truth. The truth is you have somebody like, you know, Riley here, who's built her potential up. You have somebody like me who I thought the shackles were coming off. You know what, if you were listening to that song that, when you came in, what was that song I was playing by the Canadian artist that just won a Juno Award?
Nothing Holding Me Back.
Nothing Holding Me Back. All right? And so that's what I feel. I think Riley feels the same. It's awesome. So that's the mindset. We're going to coach your kids to not take that label, to make sure that they don't know that that's a handcuff, a sentence for life. It's not. They can break away from that. And better yet, wouldn't it be nice if we could check the kids from birth, right? So like Margarita talked about Eliana, she's been checked since she was 1 week old. My kids were checked. My wife didn't even hold them first. She gave them to me. Can you imagine giving birth to your child and telling your husband, make sure you check them to make sure that their spine is properly moving and functioning so that their brain can send the signals down? That's love. All right. See, detoxification is another one, and I just want to talk about what happens. So detoxification, just to back up here, detoxification, I think people know that toxins are prevalent now. The kids today growing up, the environment, the air you breathe, the food you eat, it's the toxins are so available now, or, you know, there, present, compared to when I grew up even. The toxins were way less then, and compared to our grandparents and so on. They've even measured now the toxins go through generations, so that when they measured the blood of kids at birth, they're measuring toxins that were banned 30 years ago are still in their bloodstream. They have many toxins to deal with. But I want to talk about the most underrated factor, fundamental here, is the nervous system. And so Deepak Chopra, one of my favorite authors, in his book Quantum Healing, he says that your body has a wonderful pharmacy. Inside, it can make antibiotics, anti-cancer drugs. It can make hormones. It makes, in fact, everything. And it makes it for the right dose, for the right organ, for the right time, with no side effects. How cool is that? Isn't that pretty cool? So what controls all that? You can call it innate intelligence, as Deepak Chopra says. You can call it God, life force, Mother Nature, whatever you want to call it. What is in control of your body working properly? Your brain, that's right. Your brain, and that's why our fundamental two is the most often neglected, because in medicine, when you go and get a checkup, do they ever check how your brain's controlling your body? Do they ever check the signals up and down? And the answer is not too often, only when you need neurosurgery, pretty much, when it's devastating damage. And so we have a test, we measure that, and that's why we think every single child should have a checkup from birth, and we're going to show you why. I'm going to give you tips and stories about what you need to do. So you see, when somebody, the best case is that we prevent it from the first place. But what happens here, if you read along here, this is the lifestyle medicine guidelines. So if you have a condition like I did with asthma, or Riley's condition, what we're going to do is we're going to write a letter to your doctor, because we don't take you off the medications, okay? And we don't want you to go off like haphazardly. There has to be an organized way to do it. And so in these, there are guidelines in lifestyle medicine that say, when you're on our five fundamental program, this is how you do it. We send a letter to your doctor, and the doctor, catch this, when the underlying lifestyles are addressed, patients are often able to stop taking medication and under their doctor's supervision. Likewise, they can often avoid surgery as well. Does that sound hopeful? To me, it sounds hopeful. It sounds like you have a choice in your health on how you're going to be healthy or not. And so in the case of psychotropic drugs, and that word, I want to explain that word. Psychotropic literally means to alter your mind with chemicals. So somebody who's taking a psychotropic drug is not psycho or crazy. They're taking a drug for which they, because in medicine, what do they give you? They give you a drug, so they want to change your physiology or your mind chemistry or your body chemistry with a drug. So in one case with ADHD, it might be that you're going to take that to alter the way you think. It may make you calm down, but it doesn't allow you to be creative and be your best. You see how creative we have as an example tonight. For me, the chemicals opened my airways. And thank God I had those, because I wouldn't have breathed without the inhalers. One of the toxins was propane for me. Back then, the propane was a propellant besides the other chemicals. So you can imagine why I detoxify myself, okay? 9 years of propane for my lungs. So this allows us, this Dr. Bragan has a guideline for how to come off these medications, and we follow that for people on psychotropic drugs. We know that healthy kids are going to model healthy adults, but unfortunately, unhealthy adults are going to act as a mirror, and the kids are going to follow them. So most people think that it's all about their genes, when in fact, we know the research shows 5 to 10% of conditions are due to your genetics. But what we know is that even though you might take after your father or your mother or your cousin or whatever, it's most likely not your genetics, it's most likely that you're eating the same way that they did. It's most likely that you're exercising or not exercising the same way. You've got the same habits of your lifestyle. That's the more likely cause, what the research is showing. And guess what's under your control? Your lifestyle. It's totally under control. That's why I get excited about this, because we know that it's under control. The immune system, we talked about that with cancer cells. Most of the childhood illnesses now, diseases that are getting worse and worse, that are we're trying to fight with, manage with medicine, they're getting worse still, is because their immune system problems. Type 1 diabetes, asthma, allergies, you know, these things with eczema, the gastrointestinal problems. We know that what's happening is that your brain doesn't recognize your own body's cells, and it will attack them. Part of it's toxins. Part of it's because your brain doesn't get the communication down. So what we're going to do in the wellness, remember the wellness philosophy, is to find out where you're going wrong with the five fundamentals. What's stopping you from building the health? So that's what we look for. And so we know when it comes to these immune diseases, that it all starts from birth, even before that, because the research is now showing that that, and we've got these resources. All of these things that I'm saying are covered in our resource section. And so, Diane, I'm going to have you put that up at some point before, probably when I get to the nervous system, okay? So they can see where to go on our website. So you'll see about antibiotics. You'll see about how your first, as a child, when you come out through the birth canal, that you're actually ingesting from the front section from mom, if you go out live through that way, and you're ingesting from the back section. So there are microbes, microbiome. Anybody heard of that word? Good. The microbiome, and most people know probiotics. You heard about those? Okay, so those are the good, healthy, you know, there are bugs living in us. In fact, there are about as many bugs in us as we have our own cells. And most of them are residing in our gut. We have them on our hands, we have them all over our skin. So when you take the antibacterial soap and you wash that off, do you know what the research has shown? It's shown you're more likely to get a worse infection because you've taken the one layer. So it's like a gang, a turf war. This gang that's normally on your skin, it's there, it's actually helping you from having other worse gang come in and take over. So the worst pathogenic bacteria you can put in your mouth, but the regular bacteria, they don't cause you problems, and you start using things and interfering with your body's ability to be healthy, then there's trouble. Interference comes from antibiotics. When you're actually the mom and you take the antibiotics, it shows that the microbiome, those 70 or 80 trillion cells in your gut, they actually start getting destroyed when the mom takes that, and then she can't transfer that natural microbiome through the birth process. And so what they thought was is that your microbiome will replenish itself. And now the research is showing that they're not sure if it replenishes itself. Maybe if you're taking the fermented foods and the probiotics as supplements, that will, it will come back to normal. But they're not sure right now. They're doing investigations. The one thing they know for sure is that the antibiotics destroy that. There, you'll find in the research section that taking antibiotics in the first couple of years of life, the first three, leads to a threefold increase of asthma as a child. If you took one course of antibiotics in the first 3 years of life, it leads to a threefold increase in asthma. Do you think I had antibiotics as a kid, as a young kid? I had them right from birth, right from birth, okay? And so I'm not happy about that, I'm just telling you that's what it was. So, and people say to me, Phil, you talk about medicine so much, you know, but the problem is that about 60% of the people coming in that are coming in with symptoms that they want those symptoms to go away, about 60% of them are taking medicine for which the side effect is the very reason they're coming in. And that's alarming. And they did a study of 1 million kids, 1 million children, 18 and under. And this was done a few years back, and that's about 30% of the kids' population back then. They studied them for 12 months, so plus two. So 12 months, and what they found was is that about half the kids were on a drug that in that 1 year time frame. And what they found was that 76% of the drugs that they used were antibiotics. Okay, so this is very common. This is why I'm spending a fair amount of time on this. And that the 18% were like me with the inhalers, and that about 6% were on the psychotropic medication. They're now giving kids antidepressants under 5 years of age. Okay, so that's what's going on. That's the solution. So I'm gonna ask you, does 25 and under drugs provided by your government, so some people say, they say, oh, the kids are gonna have free drugs. And I ask you, are they free? Are the drug companies donating them out of the goodness of their heart? Okay, so it's coming out of yours and my tax dollar. So what I want, I don't want them to not have the drugs. That'll help them in a crisis. But what I want them to do is to know the truth about health and healing. And those drugs will never increase their bank account, their health account. It always depletes it. Okay, it may save them, and it may be useful in a crisis. So even more alarming to me is not the rate of use of the drugs possibly, but this fact. What they found was when they looked at the research behind the medications being used, what they found was is that for a large number of these drugs, safety and efficacy among children has not been established. What does that mean? means it's experimental, and they don't know if it's going to help you, and if it's going to actually be safe.
They don't really test it.
They don't test it. That's what they're saying.
The numbers of tests are very small.
It's very small,
yeah.
Unfortunately. Now, we're not saying kids shouldn't have medications, but I want you to know as a parent, if you're walking in and thinking everything's scientifically validated, it's not. And so I want you to know that you have options. You don't have to take drugs. And I'll give you an example when it comes to common infections coming up. But what I want to do is just take a look at the psychotropic drugs. About 6% of the kids 18 and under were taking it during that time. Is that they looked at what are the adverse reactions with those psychotropic drugs, and what they found was 28 case examples of kids that had cardiometabolic problems. They had increased weight, they had increased blood pressure, increased cholesterol. So even if those drugs weren't associated with those problems, now what are those kids going to do when they get to the doctor? What is the doctor going to do with them, I should say?
Get more medicine.
They're going to have more medicine. And here's what we know is that they've never tested two drugs together for safety and efficacy at all, ever. It's never, even in adults, there's no research when a person's on two medications to show how they interact, are they safe, and are they effective. They measure them on healthy people, one drug, and then they say if it's good or not, if it's safe, and if it works. So I just want to let you know the current research, because we used to get attacked that we don't have science behind us. And so I just want to let you know it's not scientific. No one is perfectly scientific. There was a recent research study that showed that the brain, so this is Colleen's video. We don't have Colleen's video. I just want to give you a summary. It's going to be on the resource section. But I wanted you to know about the brain coming up, and we'll get back to that with the brain research. But Colleen is talking about her son who also had trouble focusing and so on in school. But he was at the age, he was getting all sorts of ear infections. And so when I met Colleen, I didn't get a chance to check her child before he had his first set of ear tubes. So he was on antibiotics a lot, like I was. And back in the day, they took the tonsils out for me. I'm not sure about if anybody else had their tonsils removed, but these days, they don't do the tonsils so much, they do the ear tubes. Okay, so what happened with Declan was he had these ear tubes put in, and they, I don't know if they worked or not, but he had to have them put back, so it certainly wasn't a permanent solution. And so I convinced the mom to have her son checked first. And this is a year and a half later now, and he's never needed those ear tubes. He's been at school more than he's been missing school before. He's healthier. He's added to his bank account. There's a section on the resource section on our website that talks about how you build your immune cells. There's a section on there, so I want you to get to that. And so what she also said was that she added supplements to her routine for her son, and she feels that helped along with the chiropractic care. She also goes on to talk about how her MS, her multiple sclerosis, which is another autoimmune disorder, how that is has actually been affected too. Okay, so very important. So she could actually walk, you would never know that she had that diagnosis now. Right, she's been affected by that for years. She wishes that she had known about what chiropractic care might do for her. So probiotics are something. So pro means to add to life. Anti means to take away from life. So antibiotics are trying to kill the bacteria. Pro are trying to build the good ones up. Remember, the medical side, they're trying to kill the pathogen. The wellness side, we're trying to add to the health. That's the difference, the philosophical difference. That, so Allison had a testimonial, and so I think we have it on there, Diane. Allison's testimonial.
No,
okay. Okay, that's okay. So Allison's testimonial will be on the website, and so you'll see that. And what she basically said was that her and her husband were coming in for chiropractic care first, before they ever had kids. And so she said, well, adding chiropractic care probably helped them get kids, number one. But number two, because seven out of eight couples, by the way, that were trying to get pregnant, even when they had in vitro fertilization, were able to get pregnant in one of the studies. They were able to get pregnant after they added chiropractic to their routine. And what I'm saying is, your brain controls every cell. It includes the hormones and how you function. It's a very important thing for if you're trying to get pregnant as well. It's also important for helping health of the baby, even before the baby's born. and I'll explain. But before I get into that, I want to talk about, this is where Diane, we need her to put that section up in the resource section. Okay, so what I'm going to do is just talk about in a common thing. So when we say core chiropractic, raising according to design, I'm talking about the philosophy of wellness. So if our children are 19 and 15 now, right, and they've never had one prescription medicine ever, not once. Did you know that was possible? 19 and 15. It sounds outrageous, doesn't it? Okay, now my wife and I aren't against drugs. We're not against them. We think they can save your life in many circumstances, and we think they're a valuable part. We don't want to discourage you from taking them. If you're going to die, make sure you take the drug, and then you come here after. Okay, but what I'm saying is that if you build your wellness, your health account first, the likelihood of you having to need any medication is lower, because you're fundamentally higher at a level of function. So it's not that my kids never got sickness. It's not that they, so we had colds, we had flus in our house, croup, I think we had 2 ear infections. And so what would happen is that mom usually would take them to the doc, and for instance, if it was like a sore throat, but what did we do? Did we just get them, most of the time, what happens when the doctor looks at the kid? Do they do a swab most of the time when they look at the throat? No. Did you know, and this is one of the sections, so we're gonna need Diane.
Yeah, she left there.
Okay, this is one of the sections where it's on the resource center, where right from the Canadian Association, it's one of the associations they have for pediatricians, it says right on there that a doctor cannot tell if their child has an infection by looking. Were you aware of that? You cannot tell. You must do a swab. It has to be measured to see if it's a virus or a bacteria. So what ends up happening if it's a virus and they give your child an antibiotic? What ends up happening? Does it fight the pathogen? So let's just say the medical side, we're fighting the pathogen. Will that work if it's a virus and they give an antibiotic? No, antibiotics cannot help viruses. They can't help them. And so what it does, though, is it takes your natural bacteria in your gut, your probiotics, and it actually wipes them out. Yep. So it actually wipes them out. And so we've got that on the resource section of the website that Diane's going to pull up there.
Do you want to pull that now or when you're done?
Okay, we'll pull it up when we're done.
Okay.
I planned on doing it, but that's okay. So what's going to happen is that you can see that, and then you can see if you have a, like bronchitis, can you get the sputum sample containers on? Thank you. Okay, so the sputum sample containers, what do we use those for? When you're coughing stuff up. All right, when it's usually coming from your chest. So it's the same thing. Do you know that about 75 to 80% of the bronchitis and pneumonia is what? Viral or bacterial? It's viral. Most of them are viral. And so what you need to do is you need to cough that stuff up, get the sputum container from us or from the lab, okay? And you need to get that measured, because how many different types of antibiotics are there? So there's lots of different types. And so if they don't measure, even if it is bacterial, they need to measure exactly which one it is so they can give the right antibiotic. Because how many times do you hear, I'm on my second or I'm on my third round of antibiotics for this infection? Do you hear that? I hear it often when people are coming in as new patients, but I don't hear it very often when they've been here for some time, because we've built their health account up. They don't need that. And so that's one of the things. The other thing that I want to point out is fevers. Fevers are very misunderstood. What does the fever, what's the purpose? From a wellness perspective, why do you want a fever? What do you think?
Burning out the germs.
Yeah, it burns out the germs. Your body, it's part of your immune system, so it's a cascade of events. Part of it is to raise your temperature, which actually increases the amount of white blood cells you have that go and eat up the bad guy. Now your white blood cells, they actually know if it's a bacteria or a virus or if it's a parasite. And if you're working properly, if those five fundamentals are working for you, you're going to fight whatever that pathogen is better. You're going to fight it better. So if you're eating better, you're going to fight it better. If you're exercising, you're going to fight it better. if you were having a proper nerve system that allowed your brain to communicate with the cells, you're going to fight better. If you have less toxins, if your mindset is good, if you think, geez, it has to run its course. Why is the course different for one person? Have you heard that? It has to run its course. Why is the course like 3 weeks for one person and one day for the other? Because that's what happened to my kids. They would be telling us about all the kids that were off for weeks, and they, if, when they got sick, they were only off for a little, like, short amount of time. They fought hard. Their temperature increased. We didn't bring it down. The fevers, they are designed to increase your white blood cell count. And so please, look on our resource section. You'll see that there's never been one harm, like death from a fever. Never one that they've, no brain damage. That was a myth. Okay, it's been proven that that's not true. And what they have proven is that if you lower your fever, what happens? If you interfere with your body's natural ability to try to be healthy, you can get something called Rye syndrome, which could be deadly. So you could actually, by taking common medications to lower the fever down, you could do yourself in. You could certainly cause more damage, and you're certainly going to have that bug stay its course for a lot longer because your immune system can't fight it off. Does that make sense? It's amazing all these things that people don't know, and that's what we need to educate them. Your brain controls this, and so even in utero, if a mom's like this and their one hip's higher than another, even if they have no pain, what's happening is the baby's getting squeezed at an angle that they're not meant to be squeezed at. It's putting pressure on their spine and causing troubles with their spine even before they're born. Now, when they come out of the birth canal, there's a fair amount of force. I'm not blaming the doctors, because you've got to get the child out. However, subluxations at birth are very common. And so what we've found is there's other common causes after. And so jolly jumpers, the thing, let's just, you know, let's make them run ahead of time. So maybe, I'm so proud my kid can run. Don't help them run until they're ready to run. Let them progress naturally. There's a wisdom inside your body to do things at the right time. Like Dr. Chopra said, the right time for the right dose for the right organ, your body knows when. When our kids were born, just to describe the innate intelligence, I said, put them on. You know, when my son was born, put them on to latch on. And she said, well, he doesn't know what to do. I said, it's innate intelligence. And what did he do? He latched on. But I did adjust him first. Okay? And so he had more innate intelligence, in my opinion. Okay, so this coming out of the birth canal can give, I don't know if you know, but there's some rotation and there's some cranking of the neck. And so what happens is that there's, this is in our resource section, two medical doctors talking about birth trauma, and they're saying it can cause spinal cord injuries. And so in a normal birth, they're saying. Dr. Gutmann, he is a doctor in Germany, and what he discovered was he checked 1,000 kids at birth. He actually measured that. All he did was check the very upper spine in the neck, just one bone, the very top one, because it's the most susceptible. He found that out of the 1,000 kids, 88.0% of them had subluxation, had from the birth process, there was trouble. And what happened was, is that he found that they were especially at lowered resistance to infections, ear, nose, and throat infections, especially from the birth trauma. Okay, and then people say, well, that didn't happen to my son or daughter because they had a C-section. And so we've got another section in the resources on the slide. And there was a doctor that comes in, and I asked him one day, I said, I won't say his name, doctor, when you deliver by cesarean, is it easy? And he goes, Phil, he says, that's why we pull the curtain across. He said, he's 240 pounds. He says, I got to get my knee up there, and I'm on the gurney, and I'm pulling. He says, it's not a picnic. That's why we pull the curtain across, and nobody's allowed on the other side. Okay? So if you thought C-sections were easier on the kids, unfortunately, no. Okay, so now there are milestones on when to get your kids checked. And one of the great pediatric chiropractors, Dr. Webster's slide here. And so basically, whenever they change what they're doing, so first time is at birth. If everything's going good and they're healthy, the next time is when they start to actually go on their elbows and start to lift their head up. You start making your curves properly when you can lift. If the child misses this stage, their neck curve doesn't develop properly. So that's one of the keys. If they had subluxation from birth, they won't be doing this as well as a kid that didn't. And that's how they make their curves. So that's how it can start. When they start crawling, that's the next time they can get subluxation. And of course, how many times do they fall when they're first sitting or when they're first starting to walk and so on? And people say when they drop them off the change table, like, sorry, but I did. I dropped my son off the bed, off the change table. You know, like, and I'm like one of those paranoid dads that I didn't want him to do that, but it just happens when you're not a bad parent. It just happens. But guess what? If they can still walk after and if they can still like look at you, it doesn't mean that they don't have a problem in their spine. Please get them checked if they have a trauma. That's the point of this. And so these are the milestones. So it works out to almost every 2 months that we want the kid checked for the first couple of years. And so when we take a look at the spine and we know it's supposed to send the signals through, I want to go through a couple of stories now. And so the one in the resource section talks about how your brain, the frontal cortex of your brain, when somebody gets adjusted, there's a 20% improvement in brain function. They call the frontal prefrontal cortex the conductor of the brain. It coordinates everything, including what you think, how you feel, your emotions, your motor coordination, and so on. And so we know that focus is involved in there. And so people say, how can you get them better? Can you give my kid an attitude adjustment? And so we used to joke about that. But we know the research now shows it's true, okay? And two researchers, one of them just up the road, Bernadette Murphy at UOIT, she's one of the researchers that found, she's a brain researcher, and she found that when you get adjusted, all sorts of things happen in your brain. Who would have known? Even I wouldn't have thought that would be that good of an effect. I always used to think, and people used to make fun of me, that I would get my adjustment before my exams when I was going to university. And I said I thought it did better on the exam, so that's why I would do it. And so kids report, now this is anecdotal, we don't have like scientific research that shows you're going to get an A versus a C, okay? But what we're saying is we know your brain functions better. That's research, that's proof. And so the upper neck, like with Riley, what happened was she lost that normal arc like a banana. And so that didn't allow the brain messages to work, but it also didn't allow her messages to go down and for her to be healthy. And so athletics, so she's a dancer, she's an actor. Athletically, she's probably more coordinated now. This is why your athletes get adjusted regularly, why professional musicians, professional, you know, you name it, whatever their, you know, sport or endeavor is, they get adjusted regularly so they can perform. They can add to their health account. They can add to that and be at a higher level of function. It's not just about disease management. And so when you go down into this section of the area of the spine and you see that's where I was affected. So 2.5 months after getting adjusted and I had that curve like this in my spine, and 2.5 months after when they unblocked, the chiropractors unblocked my nerve messages to my lungs, I was able to breathe. I didn't need those asthma inhalers. And so again, that's the philosophical paradigm. Instead of using the chemicals to open up my airway with the medications, we actually allowed the brain to talk to the lungs. How does that sound as a different solution? And it worked for me in a great way. And so then we take a look at these areas through here. And other people come in and they have digestive disorders, like Melanie, who's on another resource section. And she was a teenager when it started for her. She was down by the time she came. She didn't know about chiropractic care. She came to one of our events, one of our, I think it was a dinner. Mm-hmm. So we have these community outreach dinners. And so one of her friends said, you gotta come and listen to this chiropractor talk about how health and healing works. And so she didn't have any back pain or any neck pain, because 10% of the time that you have a problem in your spine, you can actually feel as a pain. But 90% that you have these blockages in your nerves, you can't tell. And so her issue was that her digestive glands, they weren't getting the messages. And so she talks about how she was down to 6 foods and that they were going to cut bowel out of her. That was the next step. They had her on an anti-cancer drug because that was the only thing controlling her symptoms. And when she came here, again, like me, within a couple of months, she said she could eat whatever she wanted. Please check that video out if you know anybody who has digestive problems. And for you guys on live, Facebook Live, are they still on Facebook Live?
No.
Okay. So for you guys, we're going to get this out. Tell your people that you know, even if they're in another city, we'll find them a chiropractor. If there's a problem in their spine, they need to get that addressed. And so in this area also, these are the reproductive organs. So we have teenagers coming in right now that are having, like females and males, but more of the females coming in that are having reproductive problems, like, you know, hormonal problems. And when they get adjusted, that allows them to function better, both from this level and from the neck, we know with the research. So that's why we never just check one part. We don't go by how you feel. We don't go by your symptoms. We're not treating the symptom. We're actually building your health account by checking the whole spine, finding out where it's restricted. That's why we want you to get your checkup, because you can't tell by how you feel. All right, so when we take a look, here's an example of two brothers. And so they never got their checkup till they were 6 years old. The one had autism spectrum disorder, or he had full-out autism. Now, we're not here to say that every person that's lost their neck curve will have autism, because there are many factors to this, and we don't even understand all of it. But what we're saying is that the brother that never had any real health problems growing up, they got the same attention medically, right? They went to the same doctor and so on, but nobody checked for this. And what I'm saying is we have kids that we're checking for, like this child right here, who's in the autism spectrum disorder. And this is a very common finding, and the nerve can't send the signals down here properly. You're supposed to be on the green line, like that arc. That's how you're supposed to be. And when you go forward, you put pressure on the spinal cord, so your brainstem gets pulled. So when we talk about your brain delivering the messages, it cannot do it properly. So your ability to create immune cells and so on, everything that we talked about with the immune problems, is going to be affected by that. Here's a kid that was 6 years old, and again, his doctor prescribed the ADHD meds, but nobody, I guess, ever checked his spine, because when they brought him in, and we said, can you see that curve right there? Can you imagine having a kid that looks like this and not saying anything about that? And he had been to pediatricians and doctors, and nobody checked this as a problem. And so when we checked him and we started adjusting, 3 months later, he doesn't have that, and he doesn't have the symptoms of the ADHD anymore. Do you think mom and dad were pretty happy about that? This kid went on and he won MVP for soccer. He was so uncoordinated before that. I'm telling you, it affects your athletic performance. It affects everything functionally. So how do kids get these problems? Well, did you ever sit like this as a kid? Did you have an iPhone or an iPad? Were you on computers like our kids are nowadays? Does this help their neck curve, do you think? It doesn't help at all. So the kids have more problems than we do. They have more toxins, the lifestyle, their environment. It's harder for them to be healthy. Do you know that longevity, that the amount of years that they're expected to live has gone down 2 years in a row now? And that this generation is expected to be the first generation to not live as long as their parents. And I'm telling you, this is part of the reason. Because we're having nerve interference, not allowing our brains to send signals to our bodies. It's a big deal. Here's a before and after. Again, another kid with symptoms, chronic infections and so on, just not well. And then fast forward to not even a year later, and you can see the difference, and the kid's thriving by comparison. And so that's, you can see a picture. Dr. Ummer adjusted this guy. From birth, we've been adjusting this little guy. He's an awesome guy. The adjustments for kids are safe, very, very safe. And so they're not the same as adults, right? So I think the kids know that. If we put the same force in, it wouldn't be a good idea. A lot of times like this, the mom will hold the baby. This little guy, when he came out of the birth canal, he was stuck like that. He had 3 months of physio stuck like this. They brought him in, and within two visits, this kid had about an 80% range of motion after two. And by the third, mom said he's perfect. And I said, so we got that recording on the web too. We just have to get permission to do the recording. We got permission for the picture, but we got to get the recording. So anyway, happy camper now. So that's good news. So again, the moral of the story is make sure you get the most underrated part of your health, your nerve system checked. How do we minimize toxins? We're in the home stretch, guys. So of course, everybody drinks the green drink, right? So if the kids aren't going to drink the Kool-Aid, what you have to do is prepare certain things for them, all right? Because these things, greens, are natural detoxifiers for you. And so now these minimizing toxins is a huge deal. Like I said, at birth now, kids are exposed. I talked about 30 years ago, these chemicals that have been banned 30 years ago are still showing up in the bloodstream. Now, I want to tell you about another study that measured that there, and these people had never been exposed in the environment to chemicals ever, okay? Not in the environment, or at least that's what they thought. And so they took, and they found 200 toxins in the blood of these people. They found 134 were related to cancer causing and really devastating problems, okay? And so how do they know these people weren't really exposed to it? It's because these were kids that were just born, and they measured the cord blood. Just born out of mom, and they had 200 toxins, 134 of which were shown to cause like carcinogenic. And so do we have to minimize toxins for kids? Absolutely. Can your body adapt? Yes, but if your fundamentals of your health are off, you're not going to adapt properly. You can't get those chemicals out. Your brain, I didn't talk about all the organs of detoxification, but your liver, your kidneys, your skin, your breathing, all these organs of detoxification must be able to adapt by the communication of the brain. Your body, you run up the stairs, your heartbeat goes up, you stop, your heartbeat goes down, you have a foreign invader, your brain detects the problem, it sees it without you thinking about it. That's the innate intelligence Dr. Chopra talked about. That's all those five fundamentals wrapped into one health for you, coordinated by your nervous system. So 70,000 chemicals are used commercially. So our kids are getting exposed. So this is, again, on your resource section. The point is there are more chemicals. This isn't to be depressing you. This is, if you know the truth, you can do something about it. Please don't get depressed by this, okay? So there are things we're putting on our kids. You know, the Vaseline, did you guys hear about the research on that? Vaseline? Okay, you can read about it in our resource section. The sunblock for kids, you know, like the fruit juice. These things that are high in sugar. We know these things in, hey, we used to give some of these to our kids and put that sunblock on and so on. We didn't know any better back then, but what I'm saying is we want to spread this message out. We know better now, and so the research is available. Our healthy cleaning recipes are available on our resource section. Please, you know, when people come in and we sanitize our tables, and it may not smell like Mr. Clean, but what it smells like is essential oils, and it smells like vinegar, and that's what we use to, you know, those things are natural. Salt is a natural killer. So one of those solutions to boost your immune cell count is to detoxify and help your body get rid of toxins, but also to kill bugs with salt. You know, gargling with salt is a, you know, an old strategy. The neti pot, the nasal mist, all these things, so helpful. But certainly these cleaning, don't be cleaning, especially if you have a baby crawling around on a floor and you're putting harmful toxins and they're putting the stuff in their mouth because they're crawling and putting their fingers in there. So please, you need to see what you're doing. Take inventory of all the chemicals you're using, even for our own adult health. And so you take a look at the Max Detox powder. So these powders, the probiotics, the detox, they actually taste good. Like the kids actually will eat them. They'll take them. These supplements are very useful. Of course, we have on any of our events, we always have a sale on. So I think a lot of times people come not so they can hear the great content, so they can get the sale. No, I hope it's for the great content. All right, so your nutrition. So we talked, who was here at Let Food Be Thy Medicine? I think we had a few, yep, Let Food, I think you guys were there.
Yeah.
And so I'm not gonna go over this in detail because a lot of people are last one before Resolve, Let Food Be Thy Medicine. So we talked a lot about nutrition. Nutrition's very, it's fundamental to your health, there's no doubt. And so what happens is that the kids are going with foods, you know, It's a hectic life. Parents, I understand, they just want to get the kids off, and just they don't have only so much time. One of the things we talked about was how to actually manage your time in through our promotion of this event. So you really need to manage your time and budget. And so budget not just from a financial perspective, from a time perspective, you need to make stuff ahead of time. And so if you're just going to grab the stuff that's processed, these kids, especially the conventional medicines or the conventional foods, they're going to have medicine in them. And what medicine is in your conventional meats? You guys know the answer to this, I know. There's a medicine in the food that you're eating if you're eating regular food that's a meat, that's conventionally grown. 70% of your antibiotics made by a pharmaceutical company is going to the livestock that you and I and our kids are eating, 70% of those antibiotics are going there. And so even if you don't take antibiotics at all, you're ingesting them through the food you're eating, if it's conventionally grown food. Like, so what that means is that cows will eat, chickens will eat grains that are actually fed, and they're fed antibiotics in their feed on a daily basis. Every chicken, every day in Canada is fed antibiotics, every day. And so when you listen to the, can I get in trouble by sitting in A&W? When you hear A&W's commercial and they say it's hormone free, yes, maybe, okay, I can't verify that, but what I can verify is that meat is getting, is not getting possibly hormones, but it is getting antibiotics if it's conventional. Okay, unless you're getting organic and you know the farm. So we have a resource section that allows you to get your local source without that stuff in it. That's in your resource section. So please take advantage of that. All right. Oh, let's just go on. So the first thing to change when you're changing your stuff is your protein. And if you're getting the processed, the meats that are, you know, like the processed meats, and you're just flopping that stuff on there, like the slices, those things are laced with also, what is it? Preservatives, right? And those preservatives have other toxins in there, like, you know it, you can say it. What do they have in there? What's the
MSG?
Word? They have all sorts of chemicals, like MSG. What's the nitrogen?
Nitrites,
nitrates. That's the nitrogen that's in your foods that we know you don't want to eat those things. And they're in there to keep them stable so that they'll last longer. That's why they put them in, but they're chemicals.